Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining the session. So we will be discussing rather interesting topic today. Minal told me that this topic has already been discussed once earlier, and I was like, yeah, sure, I can definitely add something more to it. So here we are. So topic for today's discussion is quantum computing and artificial intelligence. Let's go. So we are discussing quantum computing and artificial intelligence, and how they are changing today's way of simulation and computation for us. And in no ways I am a subject matter expert of quantum computing as well as AI. As a matter of fact, in quantum computing and quantum mechanics community, anyone that says I am an expert of the topic is either considered crazy or like a liar. Yeah, there are certain prerequisites that I would like you to get introduced to before moving forward. To start with, so in quantum computing, at its core, we must get introduced to a couple of concepts. It is a principle. It forms a core of quantum computing. Let's discuss them in the upcoming slides. First of all, let's see what quantum physics or quantum mechanics actually means. So to the core, putting it in a very layman's term, it is a nature of elements at the smallest level, that is atomic and even subatomic level. It is a very very toned down definition of it. It's way more complex than this, this is the level of atom where normal principles of physics won't work. Even time and gravity functions differently at this level. So there is a principle on which this entire theme of quantum computing is based on, called as superposition principle. Any of you have heard of it before, but the gist of it is a particle can exist at two positions at the same time. What that means I, Indrajit, brutally putting it in layman's term, okay? Just so that it is digestible. So I, Indrajit, can be present in Mumbai and can be at the same time present in Pune at the same time. So that forms the core of quantum mechanics. It is superposition principle. Okay. How it gets implemented in quantum computing we'll be seeing that in the upcoming slides. Okay. So let's go. So this is what a quantum computer looks like. The core, the chip that's the processor of the quantum computer, and it's attached to the motherboard, to put it simply. I'm sure in quantum computer that part is called something different, but again, for simplifying stuff, let's generally on computers we attach the processor to a motherboard. So that's how it looks. And this is today's state of the art computer. For very flashy compared to what we just saw before, very very attractive looking. But yeah, be assured, the beast is the first one that we saw. So here we can see the motherboard and stuff. The processor is somewhere glued on to that motherboard. and it's being cooled with liquid. Okay, so the system, the machine that we saw, the flashy one, the orthodox computer, the traditional one, it works on bits, and bits, as we know, are zeros and ones. So whatever our data is, like music, video, images, games, everything is encoded in these bits. And a proper approach it has, suppose for solving an equation, is a linear one. So I would like to give you a very good example to drill it in your brains. Basically, suppose there is a room which is locked, and there is a bunch of key that looks pretty similar, and you want to unlock that room, but you don't know what key actually unlocks it. So what a traditional computer will do to solve this problem is take every key and put it in the key socket until the door gets unlocked. So this process is very time consuming, where like you have to put every key, check if it unlocks, and then we get the result if it's either failure or we pass the test. Okay, let's see. Okay, so the microchip we saw, the suspended one, that is suspended inside this. It's a big black fridge-like looking thing, and that is suspended inside this thing. So this D-Wave is the company that commercially sells quantum computers, and the founder of D-Wave, or should I say the main personality behind developing D-Wave, is Dr. Jordi Rose. We will see more about him after a few slides. So yeah. So the quantum computer does not use the traditional bits. It uses quantum bits. What it means is the principle that I told you before earlier. The principle that I told you earlier, it gets applied for quantum bits. Okay, so the thing is, a quantum bit can be zero and a one at the same time. It's unlike the traditional one, where there is one and there is zero, and it is completely different. But in qubits, they can be zero and one at the same time. It's like having a box and putting two balls inside it of different colors, suppose red and black. So red ball is in A, and black ball is in B. So what will happen is these two balls will be present at the same time in the same box. Okay. So what this actually does is it helps quantum computer to compute in a very different way than a traditional computer. So what it does is it tries every possible solution all at once and then chooses the correct solution from it. So again, the lock and key example that we just saw. So what a quantum computer will do is it will insert all the 10 keys at the same time inside that lock, and from that it will choose the best one that will work, and it will discard the rest. So that's how a quantum computer makes choices, and it will choose the best possible solution for a problem. And right now, a quantum computer only accepts equations as a problem. So as long as you can put a mathematical equation together for your question, it will be easier for the quantum computer to solve it. So decryption can be achieved in incredibly less time. So the thing is, if we are able to even plug in like 50 supercomputers together to break a 256-bit encryption, it would take nearly 3 into 10 raised to 51 years to break that. compared to what quantum computer can do is it can do that in 6 months and possibly even less. So that's how powerful a quantum computer is. So let's go. So what we can simulate today is this, the left side, basically a small molecule. And whatever we are able to do today, like gaming, artificial reality, augmented reality, is all inside that small molecule that we are able to see right now to the left of the screen. And compared to what we will be able to do to do with the quantum computer chip inside our day-to-day work, traditional computers is demonstrated to the right side. That's how amazing a quantum computer can be if used in a day-to-day life. But there is a catch. This is not a proper if used in a traditional computer, there this is not a proper use of power, I would say, because it will definitely have some tremendous complications because of the hardware that our traditional computers have. So let's move ahead. Okay, so that's what I was talking about. If used in a traditional computer, it will be like dropping a nuke on an ant, and that's not pretty good. And moreover, they cost more than $10 million. So anyone with that deep pockets can definitely afford one. Okay. So these machines, these large fridge-like looking machines, are kept at a temperature of 0.015 Kelvin. That's very cold, actually. And see if they even work like fridge. Lol. Okay. So the thing is, quantum computers require zero resistance for functioning. And for that stuff, they need superconductors to transmit data. Now, what superconductor is, it basically has zero resistance. The thing is, even in our computers, for wiring and stuff, there is mostly gold that is used, or sometimes silver. As a matter of the fact, these two materials have the least resistance, and that is why they both are generally used in our computers. And I'm sure quantum computers are also using the same gold and silver wires for that. And the processing unit of the quantum computer barely uses any electricity. The only electricity that is used up is for cooling the machine. Okay. Okay. So this is just a revision of what we saw. The classical computer compared to a quantum computer, where a classical computer uses bits, that is 0101 arranged and encoded as needed, and compared to a quantum computer that uses qubits. So qubits follow superposition principle, as I told you. So quantum computer algorithms using the ability could solve certain types of problem much, much faster. That's what we discussed a couple of slides earlier. Let's move ahead with that. So this is the guy I was talking about. So this is Dr. Jordi Rose, creator of D-Wave. And he says, and I quote, "The power of quantum computer is that we can exploit parallel universes to solve the problems that we have no other means of confirming." So even I was shocked, like when I saw that we are able to contact parallel universes, even though through a mathematical equation. But yeah, so basically we are confirming a lot of things that parallel universes exist, and we are able to contact them with mathematical equations. So where are these big looking machines located? So one is located at Google's Quantum AI lab, which they recently acquired, I guess, 2 years ago. And a couple of them are in Europe, and one is at CERN. If you don't know, CERN is the same organization that found the Higgs boson particle, also called as God particle. They have that Large Hadron Collider set up from below Geneva, Switzerland. And China is creating their own, so that's a concern as well. So quantum AI, so this is the site of Google. This it goes by this name, where Google provides services based on the quantum computer. You can check that URL out as soon as the presentation is over. So let's see what Google was able to do with the power of quantum computer and AI. So Circuit is a Python framework that is used for optimizing the quantum circuits and quantum simulations. So Circuit is like, yeah, it's just what I said, a Python framework for optimizing the quantum circuits. And you can definitely, like, I didn't get the chance to look into that, but you can definitely look into it. What I did explore was the quantum computing service. So this is like AWS EC2, we use for compute basically. But this time, instead of a traditional computer, you get a quantum computer as your processor. So that's a lot of power in the hands. So thing is, for using that, you need to take approval from Google. Only the projects that are approved by Google can run on the Sycamore. That's the processor. That's the name they call for that processor. And has like it has like 50 plus qubits. So these quantum computers can simultaneously download every single program on internet, update itself, and from that choose the best and discard the rest. So the thing is, these things, as we earlier saw, this is the core principle on which quantum computers are based. So what it does is it chooses the best outcome possible for a problem or for an equation, mathematical equation. And yeah, let's move ahead. So the singularity. Okay. So I came across this term in 2016 in the Code Conference when Elon Musk described this term. So earlier I didn't knew that any such term exists. I'm not sure who coined that term, but I definitely heard it in 2016 Code Conference. So the term singularity actually has two meanings. In terms of physics, it means an event horizon of the black hole. But in IT, it means when an AI becomes self-aware of its surroundings, and it can react. It can even react on basis of what's happening around it. So yeah, even like Shakespeare once said that I think, therefore I am. So that clearly applies to the combination of quantum computers and artificial intelligence that's being used at Google right now. The house cat argument. So yeah. So the thing is, if these beings are constantly in the state of like self-improvement, which they are, you know, like we just saw a couple of slides back, they will choose the best outcome possible for themselves for solving a problem. Right now it's just equation, but it's just a matter of time we get a full-fledged operating system ready for a quantum computer. Even some companies are working on that. River Lake is one company that is working for operating system for quantum computing. So just in case, like, you know, these beings, like, which they like, you know, they want the best possible outcome for themselves. So eventually, like, they will understand that everything around them cannot update at the same time and at the same rate as themselves, and that everything includes humans, animals. Of course, we cannot like evolve at the same rate of a quantum computer. So what will happen is eventually they will turn the things that cannot update at the same time as obsolete. So basically, so humans will just be the house cats of them. Thank you.